Okay, and snap for sync. Wait. There, okay. Sorry, just a little trick I picked up. Let me move this over here. Edit scene, let me just move this a little bit. Okie dokie. And there we go. Alright, hello fellow ponies. I'm back for just this one video because I saw this and I could not pass it up. I also, dang it, Obs, I want to be a part of this next time. I'm following you now. There you go. You happy? Nah, this got you a follow. Why I was not following him before? Anyway, our shenanigans. Which is exactly what I'm going to be reading today, by the way. I saw this, and I started reading it. And I got about, 50 words in, and I realized this is going to be awesome. So, here we go. Me reading this, with my reactions live on camera. In my best impression of a Scottish accent. As you can tell, this is really fake. But I'm going to do it because I think it adds just a touch of comedic effect to this story. So I'll see what I can do to make this interesting. So chapter 1, it begins. Hail Epit. Morning in Ponyville is like head on a Sunday afternoon. Good stuff. It was like most days in Ponyville, except that this day had been eaten by a giant black and red monster. A large snake that in no way resembled any known species, to be precise. Ipep, the sun-eating god of evil, to be really specific. Naturally, it was up to Twilight to figure out how this situation was possible and how it could be fixed. Spike, she called. Send a letter to Celestia, sending her to scoot her soggy-ass flank out to Ponyville for once. There'd be magicking to be done. Spike agreed with a... Actually, wait, what if I read Twilight Sparkle in, a piratey voice? Spike! She called. Send a letter to Celestia telling her to scoot her soggy ass flank out to Ponyville for once. There'll be magicking to be done. Spike replied with a depressed grunt, directed at her more bad pirate English than the chore. See? I was right. Pirate English. Without pause, the sun swooped down and exploded. It was terrifying. Celestia threw up. As per the norm, every pony blamed Trixie because it was Trixie. The great and powerful Trixie. Several hours earlier, the great and powerful Trixie has blown up the sun, she yelled, rearing up on her hind hooves and extending her tongue, just as she expected to do. Without warning, the great and powerful Trixie was swept up into a maelstrom of energy and harmony, evil harmony, and transformed, in green text, by the way. It was at this point that, wait, links... Links? There are links in the story? I must see this. I'm a Go-Go Power Rangers. Never mind. It's not worth it. Hate all you want. I am going to skip it. It was at this point that Pinkie Pie said, this is the craziest thing ever. Thank you, Pinkie Pie, for that beautiful fan fourth wall break moment right there. At that, the fourth wall gave a terrifying cracking sound. Crack! At which point she stopped talking. Lest the universe come to a merciful end. And no pony wanted that, except Donut Joe, but nobody really cared about him. Well, of course, I don't like Donut Joe either, because he's a unicorn, and I don't like unicorns. Any of you who have talked to me for any extensive length know that I hate unicorns, except for Trixie, because Trixie is also the best unicorn. Moving on. Besides, the universe was where most ponies kept their stuff. Obviously. Every pony knew that the fourth wall was a physical object, and thus, like the sun, and unlike all other metaphorical concepts, was vulnerable to being destroyed. I mean, come on, who doesn't know this? The ponies around her merely ignored her, because she was an unrepentant knuckle. You know, because... Clearly, best pony is, you know... The present. Twilight sat utterly dumbfounded, looking at where the sun had been just moments earlier. Instead, in its place, there was only a black vortex of evil and exclamation points. Ding, ding, ding. Some ponies ran, some ponies screamed, some were vaporized on the spot. Applejack just wondered why it was still bright outside. Out of convenience, thought Pinky. She hoped such thoughts would be safe if unspoken. At this thought, the fourth wall gave another tremendous groan. And its structural integrity was further challenged. Apparently, her thoughts were not safe either. Spike threw up a reply from Celestia. Screw Screw you, Twilight. You're a princess now. Handle it yourself. I have other stuff to do. You have no idea how hard it is to peel a banana with nothing but hooves. Spike, Twilight said. Do you think we should contact Luna? Nah, it's daytime. She's sleeping. If we wake her up now, it'll be the Philadelphia Pancake Massacre all over again. I want to hear about that. Whoever you are, you must write this fanfiction right now. I want to hear about the Philadelphia Pancake Massacre. Write it! Okay, moving on. Twilight's gaze grew distant. So much syrup. She shuddered, shaking herself out of the flashback. You're right. Let's sleep in Princess's lie. Why don't you just handle the situation like you always do? Spike raised his scaly eyebrows. That wasn't in any book I've read. Therefore, I'm powerless to do anything. Are you saying that you could only handle all the random situations from the past because you read about them in books? Yes. I am a huge nerd, after all. You don't say. I'm like, you don't say. Spike rolled his eyes. After a moment of thought, Spike replied, What about the time when the princess was being replaced by a changeling? You couldn't have read about that one.
Arr, that was in the Book of the Way of the Changeling, chapter 69, paragraph 42.
Someone actually wrote about that.
Well, yes, all ideas have already been written about. That's why half of Canterlot is in the library. Most books are still from the era when Celestia had every pony write one fanfiction per day. Fiction story per day, but it's the same thing.
If that's the case, why didn't you just outright say, she's a changeling? She's a changeling.
Spike, I'm the only one who reads most of these books. The girls wouldn't know what a changeling is any more than the Shevelins would know what a quarter pounder is.
You mean the fancies?
No, the proper term is Shevelin.
I suppose you read that too.
Yes, just like how I read about how Chrysalis is Empress of Nippon. Oh, I think we've caused an international incident at the wedding.
She was leading an invasion. Spike deadpan.
Right, but Napon is a valuable trading ally.
Ah, Erendel, our most mysterious trading partner.
Spike belts forth another letter. It's fine. Luna's filling out the paperwork whenever she's awake. Twilight paused after reading the letter.
Garr, how should she do that?
Spike tapped her shoulder. Twilight, remember, sun exploding? Fixing it? Twilight added,
Right, let's fix this.
Okay, I've got to think of, like, no, Spike does well through the Scottish accent, but, like, I've got to find something for, I'll figure it out as I go along. I'll ad libs. Okay, I saw before that moment. Chapter 2, why weren't we fighting a snake? That's right! I completely forgot about that. Wasn't the day eaten by, like, a black and white snake creature or something? Ithep, the snake-like god of evil.
Evil!
Okay, my evil laugh is terrible, but it's really good at moments when it just, like, happens naturally. If you ever spend time with me, you'll notice I have an incredible evil laugh when it just happens on its own, which, sadly, I can never call it up on. It's so annoying. Anyway, Ithep, the snake-like god of evil, for his part, sat utterly confused by the recent explosion of his lunch. Here he was, with an appetite the size of a planet. His breakfast of the day, that is to say, his breakfast, which was the day, a faint memory, and the lovely lump of plasma he'd had his eye on, hadn't had the decency to stay unexploded for another few minutes. But he was not going to take this sitting down. Not least because he was serpentine and thus had no distinction between sitting and standing. No legs at all. Right. He muttered to himself, in a voice that echoed with madness, terror, and other such ominous
Whom do I see about this?
At which point this card appeared out of the snake's non-existent ear. Managing. We can file you for an appointment in roughly 6,000 years. Give or take a century. Or we could just go play poker with some friends and see how this turns out.
Queen of Marksbury rules,
replied Apep without a moment of hesitation. No, Texas Hold'em. Apep furrowed his scaled brow.
Does this universe even have a Texas?
This girl shrugged. I don't know, but we're cosmic entities. Does it matter?
I suppose not. The fell god's eternally churning stomachs made an especially loud rumble. Will there be snacks?
But of course. Only the finest junk food in all the cosmos, don't you know? Wait a moment. I just got a brilliant idea. I hope this country doesn't begin. The gates of Young Sloth are the footman, and the two entered into Cthulhu's poker room, sat down, and began seeing how the rest of the day would play out. Chapter. There is no chapter 3.
Or is there?
No, there isn't. The authors forgot to write it. They say they're very sorry. It indefinitely wasn't eaten by another serpentine entity and wholly unrelated to Apep. Nope, we just forgot. Not Discord, Shenron, or Purunga. Nothing to see here. Keep moving on. Seriously. Go away. Don't look for the Dragon Balls. Signed, one of those guys listed above. Praise the sun. And we never will. Thorn.
Narf!
If you're still having problems, try turning it off and on again. Then delete System 32. Following that, try Control-Alt-Delete. Make sure you got rid of System 32. Leave System... By the way, I have to say, have you tried turning it off and on again? Moving on. Get to System 64. The kids will go nuts. Then go download some more RAM. If you can't after you got rid of System 32, you could also ask How to Basic to help you install GTA 5 onto your computer. Okay, moving on with that. Chapter 4, when it gets real. Deep within the Everfree Forest, something horrific had just occurred.
Trixie, what did you do?
Twilight gasped, looking over onwards at the grand metallic being that had formerly been Trixie Little Moon.
0111001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001100001
business, business, business. Numbers. This is working.
It doesn't look so shiny. It doesn't look so shiny to me. Twilight stared in confusion while Robot Trixie tinkered at her throat. A second later, her voice emanated from the mechanical mouth.
Ah, much better,
the cyborg unicorn purred.
Now, as I was saying,
Trixie said before standing up, a convenient thundercloud appearing behind her.
I, the great and powerful Trixie, have become the most powerful being in all of Equestria, with a body fit for a goddess. Soon all of Equestria shall be mine,
she said over dramatically, before going into a fit of cackling and sulfur singing, a thunderclap going off to fit the mood. Equestria shuddered in erotic anticipation. Its metaphorical body was anything but ready.
Not if I have anything to say about it,
Twilight said, summoning a blade of pure magic and charging the mechanized unicorn.
Only I am worthy of processing Equestria's virgins.
Trixie snarled, a set of miniguns emerging from her sides, and she also charged at the studious unicorn. Twilight lunged into the air, her blade ready to decapitate the cyborg, and then... Wait, what's going on? Hey there, guys.
Hey there, guys! Billy Mays here from Beyond the Grave with a special TV offer!
What?
Replied a momentarily stunned Twilight.
Someone call in Pinkie Pie. If any pony can fix this, she can. Might as well get her to fix the fourth wall for once. Someone call me...
someone call me?
Pinky said as she materialized out of thin air.
Alert! Alert! Fourth wall breached! Repeat! Fourth wall breached!
Hey, Pinks, we've got a dead spokesman of mimetic proportions interrupting the climax to sell OxyClean or something.
Nah, I'm sure you guys can handle it on your own,
Pinky said Pinky as she hopped into a rabbit hole.
Oh, thanks anyway. Sorry, guys, I thought that might work.
And then it did, or didn't. Didn't. Really, same thing, really. Okay, moving on, chapter 3.9, The Fall of the Fourth Wall and the Rise of Billy Mays. This just got interesting. 2 hours earlier. As revealed previously, the fourth wall is an actual metaphysical object, capable of incurring structural damage to the fabric of the universe. This raises some interesting questions. Can the fourth wall be seen? If it can, what color is it? Obviously pink, right? What is it made of? What does it feel like, smell like, sound like, taste like? How can't it, a fourth-dimensional object, exist in a three-dimensional space? How do they rent advertising space on the fourth wall? More importantly, who are they? I only bring this up now, dear reader, because it was at this point that the fourth wall gave them a final terrifying shudder. Cracks snarked their way across the ethereal surface, jumping between the ones that had already formed from Pinky's earlier antics. Small shards fell from the splintering barrier, glinting through the air like snowflakes before shattering on the cobblestone in front of Town Hall. Slowly, the entire structure sagged, imploding slightly as it seemed to curl in on itself. The mysterious wall split and twisted, warping and groaning from some yet unseen force. Suddenly, the wall expanded outwards, bulging obscenely as it stretched at the seams. The cracks tore open and yawned like jagged, gaping moss. Light began to glow through the openings, softly at first, like blood leaking from a fresh wound. The pure white grew blinding, blazing through the holes and cracks like a spotlight. The wall continued to creak and protest, straining at the final vestiges of structural integrity fled from it. The sky blackened as Celestia's non-existent sun seemed to dim down. The fourth wall exploded outwards in a blinding array, showering the center of Ponyville in metaphysical dust. Director Michael Bay shut up in bed, the soft sheets clinging to him in a cold sweat. Something wasn't right. He felt it. Somewhere, somehow, that he knew there had been a massive explosion. Normally, this would have been wonderful. You see, Michael was in the business of explosions. Some would say that Mr. Bay was in the business of making films, but Michael knew better. You see, Michael knew that the key to great filmmaking wasn't the source material, writing, script, actors, audio, crew, or anything of the sort. Michael knew that a great film required explosions! Explosions were the best visual effects, versatile enough for any situation. The acting prowess of high explosives was legendary. The roaring shockwave of an explosion could act as the most inspiring soundtrack for any scene. In fact, it was Michael's opinion that explosions should win Academy Awards. All of them. Yes, truly, Michael was in the business of explosions. But this is where the problem stood. Somewhere out there, an explosion had taken place. An explosion of such epic proportions, it had obliterated a transdimensional barrier. And Michael had not directed it. Slowly bringing his knees to his chest and curling into a ball, director Michael Bay began to weep. And you must for that terrible atrocity you have created, you foul man! Ponyvillians gasped in awe that the somehow yet colorless, prismatic remnants of the multiverses in a shattered barrier drifted like snow toward the earth, glinting brilliantly in the sunlight before settling on the ground and disobeying. One curious mare broke from the crowd surrounding the city center, slowly approaching the glittering rain, which seemed strangely content to fall only within the confines of the square. Of course, you know, we've seen this before, of course, right? No, we haven't? Oh, sorry about that. The crowd held its breath as the mare walked toward the epicenter of the existential disaster. Slowly extending a hoof beyond the intangible barrier, it seemed to be holding the shards of the fourth wall in. They watched, enraptured, as one of the ethereal flakes floated hesitantly over the mare's hoof, seemingly debating whether to continue to the ground with the rest of its discarded brethren, or take the opportunity which had literally extended itself unto it. Suddenly, the shards shot forth with frightening speed, enveloping the hoof and beginning to spread along the edge to the foreleg. The mare shrieked. I'm getting flashbacks to The Matrix here, by the way. The mare shrieked, retracting her arm in the hopes that whatever mysterious wall had held the shards at bay before would save her now. To her dismay, the now nearly gelatinous material followed her appendage through the barrier, still creeping up her leg until it reached her shoulder.
It burns! The mayor screamed, breathing heavily as the crowd intently watched the gelatin begin to seep into their compatriot's skin, a vapor-like steam rising from her fur.
As the crowd watched, enthralled by the eldritch horror unfolding before them, the afflicted mare rose, her face contorted in a mixture of fear and pain as the color drained from her face and her joints seemed to stiffen. Eventually, her coat faded to gray, her skin like stone as she stood rooted to the spot by the ghastly wrongness falling from the sky within the square. As the crowd stared at their frozen friend in terror, they failed to notice the immense, well-shined black leather loafer that had stepped through the rift until it fell to the ground, shaking the earth and cracking the flagstone paving the square beneath its weight. They watched silently as this loafer was followed by a giant, khaki-clad leg, extending into the air for dozens of meters before coming to a halt at an iron waist. The being's cotton leggings were held up by a thick, flexible fur leather belt, buckled at the... I just want to say that they really shouldn't know what khakis are. I really don't think ponies have khakis, do they? That's a topic of discussion. But moving on to what is clearly a human or bipedal figure of some sort, or something just wearing shoes. Coming into Ponyville. Above the waist, the figure was just an impressive color, was just as impressive, covered by a neatly tucked blue shirt with a crisp collar. What amazed the town folk most, though, was the thing's face. It sported a thick, short-trimmed black beard, in which rested what could only be described as the most charismatic smile any pony in Equestria had ever been subject to, its teeth gleaming white in the sun.
Hi, I'm Billy Mays. I should have known this. The chapter is the
rise of Billy Mays.
It said, its gargantuan smile widening as the booming sound echoed through the plaza. And for you, Equestria, I've got a special offer.
Chapter 6. How many chapters are there? This was written in like 3 days.
Chapter 5, chapter name, redacted. Back to the present. Twilight
stabbed the lightsaber deep into Mecha Trixie's robot heart. Having finished her incredible battle with Robot Trixie off screen, you know, because clearly, you know, basically wibbly wobbly, righty typey, stupid limey, something rhymey. Thank you for that, some Doctor Who fan out there somewhere.
News! Screamed Mecha Trixie. You fools! You do not know what you have done! Without my efforts, Apep would have eaten the...
And then she exploded.
Rippin' peaches, Lulamoon!
Cackled Twilight, and all was well, aside from the hot shrapnel that was flung everywhere.
This could have got a...
I hate new characters. I absolutely hate new characters. I've got to come up with a clever voice for them. Of course, clever names or something else entirely. You know what? I'll just stick with the accents for now until I come up with something creative. This could have gone a different way. Also, I think you're hot. Screamed Rainbow.
Do you actually feel sorry for her, Rainbow? Screamed Rarity. And yes, I am attracted to you as well.
We should go out sometime, even though I wanted Twilight instead of you. And for whatever else he said, well, no. I mean, maybe I do, but I really don't think I do. But something inside me always says I should when I really don't want to be, but I kind of do want to. Or maybe I shouldn't because of what I should, right? Of course, I'm right. Of course not. Why should I? Now, you see, this sounds like a pinky rat right here. Rarity started to wonder as Rainbow rammed her mind out into the deep reaches of the galaxy. Seven seconds later, gray goop could be seen seeming from Rarity's nose. As it turns out, unicorn braids don't take well to logical contradictions, much like hearts mechanical or otherwise don't take well to lightsabers' magic glowing swords. My apologies, I was not supposed to say lightsabers. Now, you see, this is why unicorns are inferior. Their brains are clearly very weak due to all the magical stress of casting freaking spells all the time. They just freaking melt whenever logic breaks because there's no mental capacity left over. And this is why Pegasi are awesome, because they can do this. And fly. Flying is awesome. Screw you. Applejack stared impolitely at the fashionista's magnificent snout. Big pardon, but is that your brains leaking out of your nose? Rarity whinnied. Oh, darling, please, nothing of the sort. I simply have a rather nasty head cold. And she pulled a cutely embroidered handkerchief out of a hammer space. Hammer space?
Seest thou a fan of the Elguna Shive? Particularly Hammer Space. Hammer Space. Hammer Space, an interdimensional realm or pocket universe where unfamiliarly large hammers are kept in order to be magically produced as needed, accessible only by women when something offensive towards females occurs, though it can also be used to defend men if they're just that androgynous. It should also be noted that while being hit with such a hammer does not hurt very much, it does not deal... Oh, it does hurt very much, but it does not deal any real damage. So, that being said, back to mayhem! Rarity stared in wonder. Okay. Emptied her nasal cavity. And I do mean emptied. Were somebody to knock on her skull, it would sound like a hollow but fabulous.
Fabulous!
Coconut. I'm sorry, I have this thing where I'm not going to explain that. A coconut would shout, holla holla get dollar. I don't know that reference. I'm very sorry to the world, but I don't know that reference. All of the phrases, BRB, 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 ramblings. Epip corked an eye ridge at the shenanigans of calling back an Equestria. One of yours?
Anything but. Discord adjusted his dealer's shade and laid down the flop. Queen of Equestria, get back to the ponies, narrator.
Right, sorry. So, with Rarity's skull little more than a glamorous guard, Applejack could finally live her lifelong dream. Somehow, and Fluttershy had been sleeping in. Angel was on standby with either the element of kindness or that flower from the Breezy Kingdom, depending on when this takes place, but no pony had thought to check on Fluttershy. Or had they? No, they had not. The author had simply Chapter 5-12. Sure, the idiocratic censoring of Discord by Fluttershy. Discord walked on stage. To much applause.
Hello, readers. We are experiencing some slight technical issues at the moment. Please hold on while we get back on.
Yay!
Discord looked at his microphone in surprise.
What in the yay was that
again?
It's almost like I'm
censored.
Just keep yay. Ignore it. Cthulhu called from the curtains. If I'm yay, where yay? I. Oh yes. As yay our sponsors figure yay what they're yay. We will get this yay. Yay.
Discord threw the microphone at the audience. Come on, I'm yay to help the powers that be out for once. Is this what I'm being repaid with?
Someone turn off the camera. He's going crazy. Background pony number 564E2645 shouted. Discord took a deep breath. I am perfectly yay.
Really, you centered yay when everyone else is swearing? This is ridiculous. I was being yay before, and yay, you do yays. This is crap. Who decides what yay to censor?
Fluttershy peeked out from under a rug. That would be me. That is, if you don't mind.
Discord blew up. Twice. Can you do that? Can you explode twice? The entire crew suffered cuteness-induced diabetic seizures, then blew up. Your screen went black. Well, my screen already is black, in case you haven't noticed. So, your argument is invalid. Anyways, moving on to the next chapter, which cannot be called Chapter 8, because we just went through Chapter 5 through 12. So, clearly, this is Chapter 12. Dude, just like Team Fortress, you can get hats and stuff. Totally cool. I've never played Team Fortress 2 because I am on a laptop, as you can tell, and I have no mouse. Well, actually, I have this tangle of wires. But, excuses. With the sudden rupture in the fourth wall having destroyed reality, every pony found themselves in Twilight's library, wearing a fancy hat, except for Applejack, because Stetson. Twilight was sipping on some tea, wearing a fedora, which I wish I had a fedora, I just really don't think I look good in them. She set the tea down.
So, how is every pony doing?
Rainbow Dash, who was in a derby, fine, you? Twilight shrugged. Pinky, who was wearing a fez, shouted,
"We should throw a
Applejack faces. No, Panky, we are not throwing a Celestia Dying party.
What if it wasn't damned?
Still no, damn it.
Pinky's hair drooped the tiniest bit.
I don't see why we can't throw a nice soiree celebrating our lovely chapeaux.
She uses French. I suppose I could do a,
I don't see why we can't throw a nice soiree celebrating our lovely chapeaux, Violetti said, sipping on some tea of her own, wearing a diadem.
Pinky brightened up at that. Fluttershy, who was wearing a stovepipe hat, nodded.
We should definitely have a little get-together to celebrate our hats.
Applejack faced again. Consarn it, we not throwing a hat party.
Twilight slammed on the table that was conveniently there for such an action to take place.
Order! I am present in a motion that we take hold a party to honor our hats. Do I have a second?
Second!
Pinky shouted. Applejack slid her Stetson over her face, not wanting any part of this nonsense.
All those in favor?
Twilight asked. Five hooves shut up.
All those opposed?
Applejack's lone hoof was raised.
Well then, with 5-4 and 1 against, the motion has passed. We are holding a hat party.
Twilight then sipped her tea.
Woohoo! Pinky yelled.
Sweet.
Sweet, Rainbow Dash said. Most wonderful. You have no idea how difficult this is. Most wonderful. Anyways, moving on.
Yay.
Fluttershy whispered.
Luna, damn it.
Yes. Yeah, I approve. I approve. I approve very much, Applejack. I approve very much, Luna Best Princess. In fact, where are you? Where are you?
Okay, I just picked this up from, like, McDonald's 2 days ago. A week ago. But... I don't have any of the other ones because monies, although as you can see, best pony. Moving on, I have not a lot of monies, so things. Oh, yes, that. Discord popped into the library, wearing a... thing.
Did some pony say hat party?
Everybody nodded.
Yes, damn it, Applejack said. Celestia and Luna teleported in. Celestia wearing a butter and Luna wearing a tam o'shanter.
We heard rumors of a hat party. Why weren't we not invited? Luna asked.
Applejack groaned. How did you hear about this hat party? She asked.
Celestia smiled.
Spike told us.
Twilight looked around.
Where is Spike, anyway? He's in the hole that Fanfiction forgot,
Pinky said, sipping on some hot chocolate she definitely wasn't holding a second ago.
In other words, your room.
Spike then popped his head out of Twilight's room, wearing a Well, congratulations, whoever used that word. You're forcing me to, also demonic duck, you're forcing me to look up a word. Streamel. Did I spell that right? Streamel. I did not spell that right. I did not spell it right. I'm going to copy this and paste it over here. Okay, moving on. I wouldn't miss this hat party for anything, he said as he bounded down the stairs. So anyway, what do you do at a hat party?
Meanwhile, he's wearing a basket on his head, because he's always wearing a basket on his head at the most random of times. Every pony, dragon, and Raikonoquist looked at each other. In their excitement to throw a hat party, they had forgotten to provide the parameters for such an event. Twilight hurriedly rushed over to her bookshelf, scanning titles and throwing them to the floor until every book was exhausted.
Problem, guests. I don't have a book for this. Gasp!
Applejack cleared her throat, causing everyone to look present to look at her.
I suggest you start by mixing drinks, because I'm going to have to get retarded before I even think of joining this Celestia damn ridiculous excuse to throw a party.
There is always a reason to throw a party, you
blasphemous whore.
Twilight nodded. Good idea.
Good idea, she said, heading for the kitchen.
And make 'em strong, Applejack yelled out to her.
Twilight returned, holding several drinks in her magic.
For you, Fluttershy, a hard lemonade,
Twilight said, floating a bottle over to Fluttershy. Fluttershy nodded in appreciation.
And for you, Pinky, a pink flamingo.
Pinky greedily grabbed the drink in her hooves and started sipping on it.
For rarity, I have a white lady.
Oddly relevant drink names are oddly relevant. Rarity noted in appreciation as she grasped the drink in her magic and sipped on it.
Rainbow, I made you a nuclear rainbow.
Awesome,
Rainbow said as she grabbed the drink and chugged it down. Twilight smiled and floated a clear glass of liquid over to Applejack. Applejack raised an eyebrow.
What's this?
She asked.
Straight vodka,
Twilight said. Applejack frowned.
What? You don't like it? That's as strong as it gets without causing damage.
Well, you could have gussied it up.
Pulled a knife and an apple out of the kitchen, slashed the apple into eighths, then shoved an eighth of an apple onto the side of the glass of vodka.
There, happy?
Applejack shrugged. Guess so, she said as she took a sip of the vodka, scrunching her face as she did so. Twilight smiled.
There, now that's done with, for Celestia, a tequila sunrise.
She said as she floated the drink over to Celestia. I'm impressed that she was able to mix these fast, although I suppose shenanigans because magic, but screw you, unicorns, I hate you and your stupid magic. Except for Trixie, best unicorn. Celestia smiling and nodding in appreciation.
And for Luna, some old good old moonshine.
I'm sorry, I can't say the word moonshine without slipping into like a Virginia-like accent. Because there was a friend of mine. See, I'm doing it already. Friend of mine in college was from West Virginia, and they called me Twitch. Just to show a little tangent here. And he's like, hey, Twitch, you gotta come back with me to West Virginia sometime. We'll get you some moonshine. Stuff's awesome. Anyway, moving on. Huzzah! The vision will be doubled! I can't come up with something for a while now. I used to do, like, a sort of, like, Russian-Scandinavian thing, but with the Scottish already in place, really hard to just, like, switch. And Luna cried out as she slung the entire glass down.
Another!
Twilight shrugged. Twilight shrugged, then brought the bottle of moonshine out and floated it over to Luna.
Knock yourself out!
Luna grinned madly as she chugged the bottle of moonshine.
And for Spike, a dragon slayer,
she said as she floated over the drink to Spike, sipped on it. Twilight then sat down.
And for me, purple drink!
Everybody groaned at that.
Come on, Twilight, that toad's uncool.
Pinky nodded in agreement.
Yeah, toad's deaf.
Twilight looked around uneasily.
Well, I do have a couple sheets of acid under my bed.
Discord popped out of existence, then popped back in, holding three sheets of acid. He then rolled one up and shoved the entire thing into his mouth. Every pony glared at Discord.
What? He asked. I have a high tolerance. Besides, Twilight didn't fix me a drink.
Twilight groaned and sipped on her purple drink.
Well, make sure you share the rest with every pony, Twilight said.
Discord nodded, then snapped his fingers. Every pony was surprised to find sheets of paper under their tongue, and in Celestia and Luna's case, half a sheet of paper. Discord cackled with glee.
Oh, this should be fun.
2 hours later, every pony was wrecked. Rarity was trying to make a dress out of books, and they said it couldn't be done. Pinkie Pie was baking something in an empty flower pot. I'm sure whatever I make will be magical. Rain the Dash was giggling like an idiot. Every pony is made out of rainbows. Fluttershy was shivering in the corner. Go away, 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 go away. Twilight was juggling knives. Gotta keep the mind sharp. Hee hee, get it? Gotta keep it sharp. Spike was breathing out, looking at the pretty color green.
Whoa.
Celestia, Luna, and Discord were playing cards. Celestia, I bet 5 books. Luna, I have 4 of a kind. Discord, gin! And Applejack still waiting at the table, along with Chrysalis, who was wearing a casa. I heard that there was a hat party.
I gotta come up with something. It's gotta be clever.
I heard there was a hat party.
Chrysalis asked. Yep, Applejack replied.
And they handed out acid.
Yup.
Then why aren't you out of your mind?
Because I ain't having any of this. Applejack said as she slid her hat down over her face. Chrysalis looked around and shrugged.
Is there any more?
I don't know. I'd say ask Twilight, but you might want to steer clear of her on account of that knife juggling.
Chrysalis nodded in agreement. Most definitely. Why isn't Oni Pony stopping her?
Applejack shrugged. I don't know. Probably on account that she's immortal, the 4th most powerful being in the room, and every pony could stop her is zonked out of their minds. Besides, she's pretty darn good at it, don't you think? Chrysalis gazed over to Twilight, who was masterfully juggling 13 knives in her magic.
Her technique is flawless,
Chrysalis said.
That's because I read a book on it, Twilight said without interrupting the knife flow. I couldn't really make sense of it at first, but when the acid kicked in, I just grokked the whole thing and decided to give it a whirl.
Huh,
Chrysalis said, raising an eyebrow. So check under her bed, Applejack said. That's where the rest of it was. Chrysalis nodded and dashed up to Twilight's bedroom.
Why?
Chrysalis screamed as she discovered that there was in fact no acid underneath Twilight's bed. She turned the back down, grumbling. Applejack chuckled.
Forgot about that, she said.
Chrysalis glared at Applejack.
What am I supposed to do now?
Applejack shrugged. Well, your choices are a bottle of cough medicine in the bathroom or the jar of nutmeg in the kitchen cabinet. Chrysalis raised an eyebrow.
Nutmeg?
Applejack nodded. For 2 days, it will. You might want to take it with lemon juice, though. It's right tasty.
I've never actually heard of that one. Why does Applejack know that? I mean, I suppose whoever wrote this was, you know, really knew what they were doing. I actually have no knowledge on the subject. Sort of. But anyway, moving on.
Just dump the whole thing in a glass of water and squirt a little bottle of lemon juice in it. That gets you right twisted. Chrysalis nodded and headed into the kitchen. A minute later, screaming could be heard.
Why is this so disgusting?
Applejack chuckled. I'll teach the crash apart. You see? This just goes to my lack of knowledge on the subject. Applejack chuckled. Oh, wait.
I heard that!
The changeling queen roared, before promptly throwing up in the nearest bush. When she finished, she muttered in a voice of disgust.
Oh, can we move on to the next chapter already?
The remains of the fourth wall. No, I'm sorry. There are no remains of the fourth wall. Alright, you shattered it and eviscerated it already. And then Billy Mays came. And what happened to Billy Mays and the snake? Well, the snake kind of already ate things. But moving on. Chapter 9, Pinkie Pie Style! Up, Pinkie Pie Style. Hey, we are all insane. Up, up Pinkie Style. Hey, don't ask about the missing chapters. And then the world danced, and they danced forever. Dance forever.
Apep, what are you doing to our world?
A disgruntled Twilight asked.
Stop!
Apep yelled, curling about the sky, rubbing himself in the shards of the shattered fourth wall.
Just, you know, stop.
Chrysalis rolled her eyes.
I'm not even part of this. Why drag me here? I have an actual kingdom to run. In Napalm, apparently.
Why not?
Answered Ditsy Lurpy Bright Eyes, unnamed Pegasus number 42.
Is she really unnamed Pegasus number 42?
Articles, ponies, list of ponies, background ponies.
Waiting for the page to load.
Oh, no, no, not cool. Firefox, no.
Pegasus. No.
Well, I'm not spending a lot of time searching. I'm sorry, I should get back to the story.
Depending on who you ask, I have a daughter or two, a mail route, a space-time continuum, or a crippling muffin addiction to worry about, or all of the above at once.
Hey, at least people sometimes give you a bit of originality. Time Turner, or is it Doctor Who's muttered, eating a bag of jelly babies. Hell, I don't even like jelly babies, he cried out. Trizzle aside.
Well, I know at least one pony who doesn't continue a Time Lord in Equestria, and at least he has the decency to do good world building.
Aren't we breaking the fourth wall here? Ditsy asked.
Isn't it already broken?
Asked the remains of Billy Mays, who had at one point apparently been annihilated.
I was wondering that myself.
Who cares at this point? Dr. Turner, Time Hooves, said, wearing a fez.
I wear a fez now. Fezzes are cool.
I asked it. I know. I speak baby.
But it was not to be, as at that point, a few shards of the fourth wall cracked again and turned to dust, and reality shifted once more.
2 days later, somewhere in the deepest, darkest pits of hell, the enemies of Epep were summoned.
His hunger is growing, said the Hasbro cultist, and has not gone unnoticed by the ponies. They're beginning to act as one,
murmurs in the hell pit.
As one, he hissed, his voice holding an edge of fear. We must do something now.
And they began to plot, but not really, though. Oh gosh, how many chapters of this are there? How long have I been reading? My word, I've been reading for like 47 minutes.
Chapter 42.5. Crawling in my skin. These wounds, they will not heal.
That sounds so familiar. I have to look this up. It must happen. It must. No, 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 it will not happen. This will not happen. On with the shenanigans. It was a beautiful day in the land of Equestria, considering the casual disintegration of reality. The fourth wall hadn't been broken for a while, until just now, at which point a minor earthquake occurred. Anyway, speaking of earthquakes.
BronyCon for the win.
Oh, yeah.
Rock the house. Rock the house.
Literally. We registered 2.1 on the Richter scale, 4 floors down in the basement.
Oh yeah, we did that.
Oh, yeah. Moving on. Anyway, the main 6 were gathered at the concert of 13,453 ex-platinum record recording artists. Oh, 13,453 times platinum recording artists Lincoln Logs Park, who decided that instead of writing a new album's worth of songs, they would just instead tour their massive galaxy-wide smash hit of Crawling. That meant playing only the one song. 47 times to be exact.
Discord!
Twilight shouted.
What did you do?
Donning black nail polish, black lipstick, black hair dye, black pants, how does he wear pants anyway, black eyeliner, a black guitar, black cap, black nose ring, and somehow black pupils, Twilight stared at Twilight as he tried to make out the form of the alicorn through his extra thick and extra dark sunglasses.
I have done nothing but achieve my dream of becoming the lead singer guitarist of the greatest band to ever exist in the universe.
Wait, what?
An exasperated Twilight shouted it again, unable to process the amount of blackness currently in front of her. It was the equivalent of a pony eating nothing but Oreos over the course of a week, and then after holding in for said week, releasing a torrent of black hole dark X-Men all over Discord.
What?
I'm like,
What?
You tell me, where is the actual lead singer?
Barked Twilight. Not like a dog, though, because ponies don't bark. Except for Screwloo. But nobody ever considers her.
Bark, bark, bark.
I offered him a paid vacation for the next 42 years. You know, with the whole meaning of life thing and everything.
Twilight and Co. merely glared at Discord, unable to understand the reference he made.
I have to apologize. I saw the 42, but I didn't get the rest of the reference. Despite
one shining moment a few years ago, back on the review boards of Pony Shots Big Board. That was a good moment. And Demi credited it for me. Not Demi Lovato, Demi as in my pet name for Demetrius. Reality nearly exploded. No, I cannot do that. I cannot skip paragraphs. Anyway, Miss
Sparkle, you are just ruining my image right now. Purple is so old news. Black is the new black. White, purple, green, yellow, orange, brown, turquoise, magenta, burnt sienna, or whatever color you might think of in little insignificant mind of yours.
Rarity nearly exploded into a cloud of marshmallow fluff at this and ran back to her boutique to implement new fashion line catering to this.
Now then, we have a show to play all of Equestria. You may watch if you like.
With that, the stage was ripped apart by the sudden shaking of the earth itself.
All right, said Discord, floating up in the air. The fourth wall. We may want to fix that.
Discord! Twilight shouted. Do something! Muttley! Do something!
Excuse me, my throat is... not the most soothing drink in the world, but it lubricates things.
If you know what I mean.
I'm sorry, I couldn't resist. Alright.
Oh, right.
Well, that's beyond my purview, said Discord. He grinned.
But let me tell you about a good friend of mine who might be able to resolve this. His name, you see, is Apep.
Chapter 43, the inevitable club chapter. Hundreds of hours in the future.
Look, my liege!
Candelot, Celestia said as she came to a full stop. Her guard slid into a pile with a din of whinnies and snorts.
Candelot! Candelot! It's only a flash model! Shh!
Celestia hushed her mighty steed, King Arthur of the human realm, as he kicked his sides and brought him to a head. As she kicked his sides and brought him into a steady trot. She had brought these steeds from beyond the reaches of the fourth wall to do battle with the dreaded Apep, though why exactly she wasn't sure. It wasn't like they would be useful for any particular purpose. She sighed. Another bad investment. As King Arthur began to skip, banging his coconuts together, the guards and their bipedal steeds followed suit. Clop, clop, clop. You know, Arthur, this new learning amazes me. Tell me again what you silly little humans call that amazing sound those brown nuts make when you whack them together.
It's a clop chapter.
I have to... Whoever wrote that, whichever one of you hundreds of little tappity tappers, wrote this beautiful line right here. Thank you. Well, Princess, King Arthur said as he cocked his head and banged his coconuts together, we call it clopping, interestingly enough. Ta-dum-tsh. Princess Celestia rubbed her chin with an armored hoof. Fascinating. How often do you humans do this clopping you speak of?
Well, Princess, I clop nearly every night with you ponies. Sir Lancelot clops at least thrice a week, and I have heard that Lady Radcliffe clops twice a night. She can't go a night without being around ponies and clopping. To we humans, clopping is essential to life. It is how we bond with ponies and relieve ourselves of our earthly frustrations.
Interesting, Celestia said after King Arthur finished his explanation. These nuts of coke you... Excuse me, Princess... King Arthur interjected. We do not use the Coke while we're winning, until we're winning. My apologies, dear human. Celestia, now, you see, I'm trying to figure out if you mean Coke the drug or Coke the drink, either of which would be very appropriate in this point. Situation, excuse my forgot to English. King Arthur continued his coconut clopping, musing, "Well, princess, if I recall correctly, they are used for courtship rituals for interspecies romance." Well, whatever. I skipped a line.
"Oh my,"
Celestia blushed. Have you ever..." "Yes, my dear princess. One time, late at night in his chambers, I caught Sir Lancelot clopping to the one with the lunar mounds. It was embarrassing, yes, but I joined him in support for his clopping. We clopped together all night to appease the night princess." "Amazing. My sister must enjoy you humans clopping to her," Celestia says. She continued to ride the human back to her castle. That makes for a very interesting mental image right there. "Though I am curious, do you clop for any ponies in particular?" "Actually," one knight of the round table galloped to the head of the clopping herd, "I believe your majesty clops to your highness of the celestial heavens." "Ew."
"Surprise!" King Arthur barked. "That was supposed to be a, well, surprise!"
I need to get a room shot up. Surprise threw his hands in the air, screaming,
"I owe you do it later. Besides, it's hardly surprising. Nobody batted an eye when I clapped for the Cupcake Duchess, nor when Sir Vent clapped for the Princess of Platinum."
"You mean Princess Platinum?" King Arthur raised an eyebrow as he continued, carrying the princess and clopping his coconuts together. "I hear their armies were of the greatest caliber back in the day." "Yes, indeed," Surprise said, nodding. "She had the greatest flanks of all the militaries, and her war biography was the greatest plot of all. Her plot, her flanks, her very being was magnificent, and the knights in her court would clop for the princess." "Would you clop to Platinum?" Celestia probed the clopping humans. King Arthur hummed while he pondered the question. Eventually, he nodded to his internal consensus. "Perhaps, but I do not think I would. While her flanks might be magnificent, I do not trust her plot. I would be afraid of her hiding something, perhaps a hidden lance, tucked into her quarters to impale me in the dead of night." "That is a fair point," Celestia admitted. She shifted her aching hiney to find herself a more comfortable position on his shoulders. "You seem quite trained in the art of language and arguing. Tell me, where did you acquire this silver tongue?"
"Well, princess, before I was a clopping king, I was a mere masturbator. Masturbating is doing nothing compared to clopping in court, in my honest opinion, especially for ponies. For you equines are far superior for clopping than even the greatest human masturbator." "Interesting, because we ponies should attempt masturbating in the carts as you humans clop for us. It would be an interesting account, would it not? Perhaps my sister and I should compete to see which receives more cloppers for our favor."
"I think you would make a great masturbator, princess. You could masturbate with your students?"
"That would be an interesting endeavor. As we masturbate together, I could test their endurance and vigor as they grasp their strong quills and spread their ink across the room. There would be much cleanup afterwards, but the exercise would be excellent for my little ponies." That title drop. "Ah, quills," King Arthur murmured as the castle loomed over the herd. They waited for the drawing to open. "I hear that pony quills are twice the size of the average man's and can hold twice the ink."
"Well, my loyal steed, it is not the size that matters. It's rather what you utilize it for. Besides, girth is much more important when it comes to finesse. Too small and you receive no result. Too large and you make a mess everywhere. One time, my dear sister got it all over her face."
"That's a fascinating tale," King Arthur commented, as he resumed his clopping onto the falling bridge. "Are you worried about student withdrawal in a masturbating classroom?"
"Perhaps, but my students always use protection. There is no reason why they wouldn't partake in masturbating. Now, is there?"
King Arthur clicked his tongue. "I suppose not, unless the masturbating became overly penetrating or otherwise invasive of the person or pony. Especially if there are holes in the masturbating, I suppose." Celestia shook her head. "It might need some forethought to execute properly, especially if I want my students to come inside the masturbating class. Otherwise, they may compensate for something." Interesting, King Arthur said as he galloped and clumped to the royal hall. He set Celestia down, rolled his aching shoulders, holstered his coconuts to his sides, he slapped his hands together and gagged in disgust. And now I must wash my hands, for I have clumped too much and they are covered in a white and sticky mess.
Thank you, writers of the internet, for that beautiful chapter. And I only just noticed that it's chapter 34, as it rightly should be. I need to straighten my legs. Chapter 86, A Relapse of Old Ways. Thousands and thousands of seconds in the future. Ah, the wonderful country of Shride of Equestria. It is autumn now, with beautiful colors all around. Nothing can disturb the serene... Cease thy games, wretch! Stand and face us! The serene peace. Ponies frolic, birds chirp, leaves crunch, and Princess Celestia chases a rapidly moving bubble of water through Ponyville. Wait, what was that last one?
We shall let thee sit amidst the scorching heat of our sun for thy transgressions!
Meanwhile, in the mind of the pony currently being chased, one mantra loops endlessly. Most ponies in this situation would not question how this situation came to be. Wise ponies would focus simply on questions like, where can I hide? How much longer can I run? Sadly, the stallion known as Coral Plump was not a wise pony, otherwise he would not be running for his life. Earlier that year, Coral humped and hummed an upbeat tune as he walked to the kitchens to fetch Princess Celestia's morning coffee. As he walked into the kitchen, he spotted another pony. While this would not be of any note at any other time, no penny was ever in the kitchens around at this part of the afternoon. Typically, the cook would finish preparing the mug and laying out the various dishes, then leave an hour or so before Carl walked in. Yet this mare was certainly not the cook unless she'd run afoul of Poison Jack. Her coat was navy blue, her mane only a shade lighter. All these details were filed away in Carl's mind, not to make their significance known until it was far too late. Carl grabbed the coffee, careful not to apply too much force to the telekinesis. I hadn't seen anyone else around here time of day before. He was cut off by a flash of midnight blue light as the mare teleported away. How odd, he mused, exiting the kitchen to bring the princess her coffee. Princess Celestia wasn't ready for the morning. Oh sure, she'd raised the sun, letting the servant know she was awake, but she didn't want to get out of bed. No, nothing could rouse her. For on this day she would make a stand. On this day she would sleep in, and the nobles could be. Is that coffee I smell? One cup of coffee and no small amount of grooming later, Princess Celestia was ready to attend court. Something was nagging at her, however. The nobles and even her guards occasionally sent disbelieving glances at her. Not at me, above me. What's going on? In between petitions, she chanced to look upwards. What Celestia saw baffled her, for a large pair of swirling and green floated above the throne. Pillar, sorry. Extending 2 yards into the air. What? How did this happen? Everything went normally. Woke up, had coffee, had bath, began holding court until mealtime, although the coffee certainly tasted odd today. A bit like key lime or poison, you could practically see light bulb flare. Coral! Be it out of rage or fear, the next few minutes were a blur for both the unicorn and the alicorn and the hapless unicorn. This is why I don't trust unicorns! How they went from running through the castle to racing across the countryside would remain a mystery for eternity, but the results were the same, trails of flame crisscrossed upon the land, clouds of steam and smoke falling in their wake. Eventually, Carl was caught and thoroughly reprimanded. His punishment was somewhat lessened when he mentioned the strange mare seen in the kitchen earlier that day. Coincidentally, Luna woke up the next morning to find her mane dyed pink. Carl subsequently died, and no more was heard of him ever again. The end. Chapter 3. How many chapters are there? Chapter 1337, back to APEP. Earlier, enter, the present. Having finally digested his meal, the whole day with a wash down of supernova, APEP decided to go see what the ponies had gotten up to. To APEP's surprise, they had totally forgotten about him. They instead decided that telling fairy tales were more important than him. They told many stories indeed. From what the human clubbing with Celestia to the dead TV salesman, APEP swirled his great eyes south, and to the east to the empire of Given even the unchangeable, immovable powerhouse that was Winia had changed. With Apep's great TI-82 calculator, he had discovered about 6 million Naga had died.
That was quite a lot of the snake-tailed ponies. Wait, what? Snake-tailed ponies? That was quite a lot of the snake-tailed ponies. He plugged a few more figures into his calculator, attempting to predict what would happen next. Then he ate it. In rage. Yes, Lord Ape had foreseen the future in his calculations, and he was displeased. The writers of this horrid story would forget him. Then a thought struck him. He would have indigestion for eating that calculator. The appearance of Coral in the distant future would put a large damper on his day-eating plans as well. How precisely, he was not yet sure, but it would. The fool author to... Arthur? The fool Arthur, too, would have to be dealt with. Ape had not yet come up with a plan for dealing with the two of them yet, but he had a sneaking suspicion it would involve eating them, or using them for ornaments, whichever turned out to be more practical. His heart was looking a bit bare. What's the process for mounting heads on the wall referred to as? Taxidermy? That's right. I wonder how much that costs. Ape pulled out his MacBook and began to research taxidermy. What? Those prices are for two heads? That's outrageous. He then chucked the MacBook through the computer screen, striking the current author unconscious. Cthulhu looked up from the cards. Is there a problem? Should you not be trying to conquer Equus? No, the great serpent said. I must do something I have not done in a long time. The serpent fell sideways and started twitching. Swim in the so beautiful ether that is in planetary space. Strange semi-corporeal muscles rippled under the scintillating scales of the ounce-old being, which somehow exerted some kind of friction in the biting cold vacuum. And Apep swam. He swam loops and figure eights and isochondria and tesseract. Naturally, his divine body was long and dimensionally flexible enough to pull out just about anything, don't you know? Even his evil twin, Papa, paused his own machinations to watch in awe of the from the adjacent universe, and Ophiuchus the Great smiled in benevolent contemplation of one of his most favored creations. Cthulhu looked to Dagon, who had come through yet another gate. The fish-like great old one took one to look at the serpent. What's with him? Cthulhu shrugged, stroking his beard tentacles. I think he finally lost it.
I had no idea what sort of an undertaking I was going, my lord.
Chapter Chaos, or How Apep Learned to Channel. Stop. Once upon a time, there lived a giant snake thing named Apep that ate stars. He was handsome, powerful, handsome, captivating, and above all, he was handsome. Was it mentioned that he was handsome? Yes, okay, on with the story. One day, Apep got bored swimming about hither and thither like some kind of weird giant snake thing. Did we mention he was a giant snake thing? Yes, okay, on with this. He decided to stop doing it. He wasn't sure why he'd started, but he had no idea how it would help him address the problems of his life. Because, you see, Apep was furious with his enemies. Coral, King Arthur, Bailey Mays, and Twilight Sparkle.
Curse you, Twilight Sparkle!
The whole lot. He wanted to consume the daytime, but no one would ever stand in his way. Taking a deep breath, he called forth the one thing he knew would help him even the score.
To invoke the hive mind representing chaos, invoking the feeling of chaos. Without order, the Nesbird and hive mind of chaos, Ape becomes it, he who waits behind the wall.
Chapter Order, or How Twilight Learned to Channel Dialogue. Twilight was waiting for new books. It was the only way they could learn how to defeat Apep, and yet her new book sense had not been tripped. Unlike Pinky Sense, the new book sense was simply an interracial flux that naturally occurred due to the circumstances of her birth. This was when the faint sound of loud galloping hooves finally made into Twilight's ears, and at the same time, a voice that's remarkably similar to Princess Celestia's voice shouted, "Coral!" Twilight didn't really know what to make of it when the princess... shouts continued despite the obvious villain Apep being at large. How could they be at such ease? The friendly shouts echoed around Equestria. A few more shouts later,
It seemed as if the world was about to break. Thankfully, the structure of the universe stayed relatively intact. Of course, it was only relative to the four-dimensional theory, and how true a theory is also relative, of harmonical relativity. Suddenly, feeling the sleepiness take her, Twilight slipped into her bed. I deserve some rest.
Well, I deserve some rest for all the deeds I do for Equestria.
Smiling, she started snoring softly.
I really don't like this chapter. I'm not really sure why. Also, who bewitched the chapter with the sleeping spell curse you?
Okay, I'm awake now. Anyway, Twilight didn't really know. Okay, suddenly the feeling of the sleepiness. Twilight was awakened by another scream. Somehow she knew. Sorry, too fast. Twilight was then awakened by another scream. Somehow she knew it was sunrise. Don't ask her how. Carl! Echoed once again through Equestria.
Carl!
But this time it was from Luna. Surprisingly, you would think she would never get screen time. A sickening crunch followed. Twilight realized that her new look sense had just been triggered. Book sense, sorry. Giggling, she teleported straight to the castle to find Cora's head, she assumed, crushed flat by Luna's majestic forehooves. Thankfully, there was a book for that. Crushing fetish. Thankfully, there's a book for that. Summoning dark magic, she pointed her horn straight at Luna and screamed,
"Thou shall not murder my neighbors!"
Sorry, I slipped a little bit.
"Thou shall not murder thy neighbors!"
The apple of dark magic wrenched away from her horn, shooting toward Luna at a sickeningly fast pace. Luna fell over. Twilight smiled again, knowing her spell, Mach 20, was successful. In a few days, the tendrils of destruction and chaos will spread across the universe, but that was future Twilight's problem. This writing is very bad. Walking towards Canterlot Library, she scattered her new book. After an intense hour-long searching montage, brain not functioning properly right now. At last, the new book. It was titled The Coming of Doom of All the Multiverse and had a bunch of blank pages in the back. She assumed this was because it was a work in progress. In that case, she decided she had better return it quick. Slumping down her side into her favorite reading posture, she read the entire thing quicker than she would blink. Like that. Aha! The last chapter, Chapter Chaos, or Yada Yada, contains clues to Apep's defeat. I must contact the princess.
The last chapter Chaos, or yada yada, contains clues to Apep's defeat. I must contact the princess.
Bringing up her teleport spell once again, she teleported straight to the castle. Am I merely an illusion contacted by gods who watch and plan my every move?
Twilight is becoming self-aware.
Sadly, Pinky already shattered the fourth wall and it's mostly broken, so really, this means nothing at this point. A strange thought entered Twilight's mind in the short moment she was in the rift. Never mind that rift madness. Materializing in the castle, she found Princess Celestia trapped in the dark tendrils of chaos and destruction.
Sorry, Celestia, no book for that yet.
Twilight seemed genuinely sad. For the first time in forever, her princess was not the role model she strived to be anymore. She was never the role model she strived to be! Are you kidding me? She only ever makes things for Twilight to do. Like, for crying out loud, everything, really. She just vanishes during the Nightmare Moon problem, and then just reappears magically. Oh, look, you saved the day. I can't even words right now. And then she, she's useless at the Candlelight Invasion. And then, what was it again? The next villain, there was, okay. She had an excuse for the Crystal Ponies. She's, real over Clustria. But, she sent Twilight, and it was clearly a test. It was stated as a test. All Celestia ever does is make tests for Twilight because clearly she has no power whatsoever other than raising the sun. She can do it. Okay, so she fixed the Twilight spell. She's an experienced unicorn, but she has no power whatsoever. She's just clever. That's my headcanon.
Moving on, that's why Celestia is worst princess, and Luna is best princess, because she can walk in dreams and actually does things! Anyway, fan hate aside, I am... I found
a way to defeat Apep. I just need to channel Anti-Zalgo, which I dub Zalgo for short.
Unbeknownst to Twilight, Celestia feared that the universe would truly end. When did things ever get out of my control?
They were always out of your control, you bitch.
She screamed when Twilight began chanting the chant to channel the channel to Zalgo the Zalgo, and Celestia fainted from the exhaustion.
To invoke the hive mind, resenting order, invoking the instinct of order. Without chaos, the Celestian have hive mind of order. Twilight becomes it, she who mends above the wall.
Universe shone a bright light. Oh, thank goodness there's only like 18 chapters. My voice can't take much more of this. Ibit, meanwhile, was a stupor not unlike one who is drunk might fall into. He was not feeling well, and it seemed to him rather like he'd been contracted into some kind of cult. But how? He hadn't eaten anything strange or unusual. He grimaced. He knew he shouldn't have eaten that calculator.
Well, I could have told you that, silly,
said Pinkie Pie, appearing out of thin narrative. Cackling madly and madly cackling, Pinkie exited the void.
That's too fun to do. I'd be like doing something like diabolical, and my friends will just look at me and
I don't have the lungs for it though. You need like a lot of breath in your lungs to put out that much power to make your diaphragm vibrate that way. It takes a lot of lung power to do that. I can't do it. See, I tried the first and it doesn't work right. But you know, I'm reading a story right now, so I must apologize like for like the thousandth time. I just go off on like so many tangents, like this one. Well, I told you that this universe imploded in upon itself for like the seventh time. This story, a pocket dimension sprang into being, replicating the universe prior to its destruction.
Well, was that our extra life?
Discord returned to face his newly constructed card buddies with a look of disgust on his face. Cthulhu and Apep stared at Discord with confusion in their beings.
What, you mean to tell me you've never played Nintendo games as a Cthulhu-ing?
They shook their heads. The resulting carnage in the lesser planes of reality was unspeakable. Meanwhile, somewhere less absurd... Okay, not so much less, but still. A few hours earlier, hard at work in her library, Twilight Sparkle was working on a solution to the internal problem of Aether. The insight given to her by channeling Zalgo had shown her the path forward, and at last she could see the end of this nightmare. The contributions of Cordell's research and the human King Arthur had also been invaluable. A little bit of coconut milk, some pink mane dye, it would all come together to save the day.
Insanity is everything,
she exclaimed, carefully concocting the greatest piece of nonsense ever devised by madness incarnate, this story. Meanwhile, we'll kill him with mad science.
Mad science!
She poured the virus into the vial, teleported it away, and waited. Millions of years later. Achoo! Epip sneezed mightily, sending eldritch mucus across the cosmos, striking several planets, instantly causing mass extinction to half and creating abominable, yet oh so desirable, tentacled stud muffins for the rest.
Stud.
Also the tassel worm, for those of you who read Finfiction. Bless you, Cthulhu told him, reaching for another card on the poker table.
Wait a minute.
Apep glared at the squid-like old one.
You think you're greater than me? You think you can bless me?
Cthulhu arched a squidly brow.
What are you talking? You must die.
And like that, the squid was praying for the snake. The multiverse itself had been undone. The fourth wall was rendered nothing. Again. Chapter Omega. Rest in peace, fourth wall. We knew thee well.
Alas, I knew it well.
Twilight Sparkle and her friends found each other floating in the empty dark space between the multiverse.
To the space between spaces!
There, coiling around them, was the great snake Apep himself. He had been weakened by Twilight's virus and the calculator that he'd eaten, but he was not dead yet.
"Where are we?"
Rainbow asked, looking around at the nothingness around them. Twilight sighed.
"Subspace,"
she replied solemnly. Her friends all looked at her quizzically. "Come again?" Applejack questioned her.
"The space between spaces,"
Twilight clarified.
"Or, to be more precise, the space between universes, also known as the multiverse, dreamscape, spiritual realm, Narnia, and a thousand other things, not including but limited to Terabithia. And other things!"
"Oh, okay, Sugar Cube. What does that do to get us out of here?" "Yes, and you and your friends have practically destroyed the damn thing," a certain brown earth pony said as he appeared out of less than nothing. Twilight's jaw dropped.
"Doctor?"
she said in shock, having met a version of him in one of the countless adventures the authors were too lazy to write about. "No, well, yes, but that's beside the point. Time Turner or Doctor Who's, or maybe some kind of combination Time Who's, Doctor Time Turner, James Bond. The point is, because of you six, reality itself is beginning to fracture, and will eventually shatter from the stress caused by an excess of adorability and cuteness, as well as stupidity."
Well, how bad can that be exactly? Rarity asked, a twinge of worry in her voice.
"I don't think you understand," Time Traveling Pony said. With reality fracturing, everything will be lost. Time, space, plot, sanity. Unless Apep can be destroyed, all of creation will be sent screaming into nothing." And suddenly he became a pear.
I'm sorry. For those of you who are not Doctor Who fans, I apologize sincerely. Because it's just... The joke. It's, you have to order the DVD set of one of the David Tennant episodes of... I believe it was the family episode. And I was like, and five, very important five, do not let me eat pears. I hate pears. John Smith is a character I created, and I won't know that. I might think I am him, and he might do something stupid like eat a pear. I do not want to wake up in a month with that taste in my mouth.
I can't really remember how it ends, but it was something like that.
Sanity? What sanity? And are we already in nothingness? No, wait, we aren't, because nothing is something. Something called nothing, Pinky bounced.
Discord smiled, leaning against the fabric of space.
"Oh, you bring up an excellent point, Pinky. Who cares?"
he said, grabbing the pear and taking a bite out of it, ignoring the yelp at me.
"Ouch!" "Discord!" Twilight snarled, turning at him. "What are you doing?"
"Eating a pear, isn't it obvious?"
Discord replied haughtily.
"But why? He was warning us, trying to save reality from chaos."
"Why not? He would have failed anyways, and he probably would have taken reality along with him. And me and I would die hungry, and a million other things that are beneath your concern. That's exactly why I'm doing this."
Discord said with a sneer, throwing the pair away.
"My name should tell you enough, but since you seem to not understand, let me explain,"
he said before snapping his fingers, bathing the nothingness in golden light. It shed Equestria from a bird's eye view, as if such a metaphorical bird were able to survive in the void of space.
"Here we have a world shown in perfect harmony. Serene. Peaceful." The last word was snarled out, as if it were a curse of some kind. "Now, here's the world when it isn't peaceful."
Another snap, and suddenly everything changed. The world appeared to be Apep's ugly mug, smelling cruelly while vast volcanoes formed his eyes, an enormous techno-changeling horde being his mouth.
"Nothing but madness and insanity, just the way I like it."
"I thought you only liked chaos and insanity when you were the one causing it."
Twilight, you know, that's just scroll, button, touchpad things.
"Who said I wasn't? You can't understand chaos. Chaos's definition might not understandable." Monologue before snapping his fingers and creating an orderly list on a whiteboard of chaos. Showing it to his enemies. "See, this whiteboard is chaotic, because I made it, and since I'm a being of chaos, it is unpredictable that I would create something orderly."
But
It's just a whiteboard.
Twilight said, confused as to why Discord's monologue was still going on and what his actual point was. He was also amazed that Apep had not shut up yet. Surely he would want to confront the ones who could stop him. Unspeakably, Apep.
Praise be to him. I am Apep. Hear me roar.
The Egyptian god of chaos hissed as he... Oh, that's what it is. As he appeared from the schoolhouse of nothing, looking down at Discord and his puny whiteboard. Apep snapped his jaw and summoned a bigger whiteboard, better than Discord's.
And why should you put Equestria into eternal chaos?
Apep hissed. Hissed.
Twisting around the Triconoquist.
Let me think. Discord said, putting a paw to his chin as if deep in thought. His paw, by the way, he only has one.
Why not? I mean, I am the equestrian god of chaos, and hey, I don't get my ass kicked nightly by my sun goddess.
Celestia teleported in Discord's backside before inexplicably disappearing with the parting shout of,
Molestia strikes again! Yes. Yes, you do.
Chickle day pep. Discord grumbled, rubbing his backside.
Well, better than two sun deities.
Apollo flew in and promptly slammed his fist down onto Discord's cranium.
Shazamity-lam! He shouted triumphantly, and then shot off into the distance.
Oh, come on, Discord shouted, rubbing at his now aching head. I don't even know that god.
Apep snickered and hissed simultaneously. A sort of sniss, if Apep will. Meanwhile, Twilight and Co. slowly backed away from the gods of chaos, wondering where the nearest exit was. Apep, as if reading their minds, pointed at a big neon exit sign. The door was shaped strangely like Apep's jaw.
Please do leave. I'd rather not have a bunch of children disturbing me.
What did you say?
Twilight asked, her voice soft but stern. Apep turned around, his face a wide smile.
Oh, did I insult the little princess's student?
He said, cackling.
Compared to me, you're insignificant. Nothing. A child. I only give you the choice to leave because I'm simply annoyed with you all. And I don't want to hear your annoying prattle as I burn your world. He sniffed. Also, I appear to have a cold. And I'm not in the mood. So, in short, go away.
He said, his voice as cruel as the desert. Twilight turned around, her eyes cold.
No, she said.
The vast snake reared back, blinking in surprise.
What?
No, the opposite of yes. A negative statement,
Twilight said, her voice becoming more passionate as she walked toward the vast snake. It stared in confusion.
As in, not agreeing, forming a different opinion, and in some extreme cases, actively going against the wishes of others.
She furrowed her brows and shut the snake deity in icy glare.
The last example being the one currently on display, from me to you.
Apep's eyes narrowed as he glared at the tiny unicorn.
You dare defy a god?
I've done it before.
I've done it before,
Twilight said with a shrug. Apep roared at her, a sound that promised unimaginable pain and agony. I can't imitate a roar. I'm very sorry. I'm very bad at imitating roars.
Come on. Why are you so grumpy?
Pinky said with a pout, leaning on top of his head and looking into his vast eye. Apep reared back in shock, throwing Pinky away.
What the? How did you get there?
He said before shaking his head, snorting.
Enough! This shall end. With cupcakes and a party!
Pinky exclaimed, happily bouncing around in circles.
I'm more of an apples mayor myself, but I could go for that,
Applejack said, while Apep's vast, godly eye began to twitch.
And I as well, darlings, Rarity said with a haughty smile, though I must say your skin would make the absolute finest snakeskin boots. She eyed the snake deity's exterior with a slightly mischievous face. Boots fit for God, in fact. She giggled at her intended and slightly clumsy pun.
What, annoyed they don't find you to be a threat?
Discord said, piping up, reminding the readers he hadn't been dealt with yet. I mean, even Rarity is saying she could fight you, he said with a snicker.
Do you all have a death wish?
Ip exclaimed at them.
Because if so, I will gladly play genie for a bit. Ooh, I have a bit in my saddlebags, Pinky exclaimed.
Yet popping into the story for only for comic relief.
I find him frightening, Fluttershy squeaked. You're scared of everything, Fluttershy,
Rinda Dash jibed.
Even your own shadow is seen in season 1, episode 7,
Pinky elaborated. She bowed to the audience as a rim shot followed through, echoed through subspace. I'm sorry, that was really bad. I like Pinkie Pie breaking the fourth wall, and I find a lot of her jokes funny, especially her random, slightly relevant antics. But that was really bad. Like, really, really bad. Also, what are you staring at right now? Okay, you can still see me.
I don't intend to fight him, Discord.
Rarity replied to the I'm sorry, an hour and a half of reading kind of wears out my lips a little bit. I don't intend to fight him, Discord, Rarity replied to the Draconicus, completely ignoring the previous exchange. I intend to outwit him. She pulled out from behind her back a seemingly empty hoof.
With this.
Ipit peered down at Rarity's hoof, and frowned confusedly.
What's it supposed to...
His statement was cut off by a tiny explosion upon his forehead, which caused him to stagger back a little ways.
What happened?
He shouted, a hint of fear in his tone. He spotted Rarity, rubbing her hoof against her side nonchalantly, to which he glared icy daggers at the pristine white unicorn.
What did you do?
Rarity smirked slightly without meeting his gaze, which would make a certain snake-eyed haired goddess blush if she were there. Oh.
Have you forgotten where we are, dear Ipep?
Ipep snorted steamy breath from his nostrils.
Of course I haven't. We're in the multiverse.
Right, she replied, her smile taking on a sinister edge, meaning we have access to literally anything and everything our minds can imagine. Ibip stared in confusion for a brief moment before a realization struck not just him, but everyone else. Immediately, everyone present began brainstorming the most awe-inspiring, violent, lethal, and awesome things she could imagine. Rarity equipped a jetpack to her backside and twin purple magic glowing swords to her hooves. Fluttershy armed herself with a hydraulic 20mm Vulcan V8 six-barreled minigun, capable of firing 6,600 rounds per minute with a muzzle velocity of 1,050 meters per second, complete with a million-round belt of 7.62 NATO custom machine incendiary elemental enchanted rounds. Excuse me. Rinda Dash procured an enormous scythe, which might or might not have belonged to Death himself. It easily dwarfed every pony present in combined length. Applejack summoned full-body power armor with an MK-19 grenade launcher, which had extensions of other grenade launchers, which would have other grenade launchers, all mounted under her back. Each grenade fired would explode into other grenades upon detonation. She removed her Stetson and withdrew the Holy Hoof grenade before placing the hat back atop her head. Pinky Pi pulled out translucent shards of the destroyed fourth wall. I approve. Twilight had got really creative and summoned a spellbook on how to kill snake deities. Written by Starfire the Bearded, with a foreword by the great and powerful Ultra Mega Trixie. Discord decided to remain chaotic neutral, and summoned a set of bleachers, multiple stack stalls, and donned himself a jersey which read, "Referee." Multitudes of random and quiet, diverse characters from all across the multiverse started pouring into the stands, all rushing furiously to find a seat before the grand spectacle started. Who even is that? Well, this certainly looks to be an exciting matchup. Lady Palutena mused as she took her seat. Indeed it does, Neo affirmed as he took one next to her. Can someone change me back to normal? Dr. Perhus whined, or whatever he was called now, only to be completely ignored. Will there be blood? Rick Taylor shouted from way up in the stand. I must say that I don't know who half of these are. I'm really just making things up as I go. The mask attached to his face, delighted by the prospect of witnessing a blood wrath not instigated by them. Oh yes, Jigsaw replied, turning to look at him. There will be blood. Pika Pika! Pikachu replied, which loosely translated as, off with their heads!
They're going to lose their heads, they painted the roses red.
Shh! Discord said, pulling out the bag of popcorn.
The show's about to begin.
I love a good show, Dementio giggled evilly.
Where's the gambling booth at?
Homer Simpson asked aloud, turning his head around each way in search of said money suckers, despite having no money on his person.
Are we playing a game?
Billy asked.
Billy asked Mandy and Grim,
of whom the latter waved a dismissive bony hand at the scythe Rainbow Dash possessed.
Let's go, Mario urged.
How did I get here?
Said Prince Staghorn of the Changelings, and the son of another Ponyverse Chrysalis unrelated to the one in this story. Multiverse rules and the fact that you're a low-grade author avatar, dear, said his wife, Devil.
What's going on?
Snowdrop asked to no one, hearing around while Nyx had an expression of confusion etched on her face.
I still need to read that.
Okay, I've got to show you this. I have a poster signed by Penstroke because I met him at BronyCon on the panel, which I hosted, that he was on. Yeah, things. And I haven't read it yet. I'm sorry. I keep meaning to read it. It's in my read later list, which is growing every day. It's got over 100 stories in it, which I haven't read.
Mom? She said, looking down at Twilight down in the arena.
I said, shh.
Discord repeated as the fighters lunged at each other with their summon armaments and allies.
Insert epic fight music here.
Do 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 do. Mortal Kombat!
I'm just sorry. More epic fight music. Wait. I've got the perfect solution.
And turn up the speakers.
We'll be right back.
With one of her magic swords.
How have we not finished this yet? The hurts.
Gods of the universe, thought in a noise.
Just keep it going. It may end if we just keep going, one of the gods said, annoyed.
Or it could go on forever because we were stupid enough to get those mortal brains to use for creative purposes, started another god.
I suggest we change the music, one of them piped up.
No, all the other gods shouted.
No, go away. Girls, out of the way! I'm finishing this.
Wait.
Prepare to meet your maker! Dash shouted.
Wait. We could change the music.
My favorite theme. It's about to get upbeat and epic in here.
We'll be right back.
selfish disdain. Eventually, the power of peer pressure got to her, and she groaned in exasperation. No, don't give in! But she had to. Fine, she shouted. I forgive him. Nothing in satisfaction. Twilight returned her gaze to Apep.
Well, what do you say, Apep?
She asked him.
All right, he croaked. I forgive me, too.
There we go. Woo!
And he snatched them all with his tongue and swallowed them.
Which the spellbinding circle immediately had vanished. There was a heavy silence throughout the stadium as every single person's brain digested what had just happened. Just as the main six were to be digested in the Apep's stomach. With a mighty groan, Apep took a moment to stretch before flashing a cookie smile at the audience.
All this trick in the...
Apep was about to praise the sun when he was cut off by a sudden heart attack. He collapsed dead on the ground, which doesn't exist, by the way, because they're in the multiverse, his tongue rolling out of his mouth and his eyes glazing over. Twilight's calculator virus, it seemed, had finally caught up with poor Apep. Everyone in the stands simultaneously blinked in confusion. In the stands, Horatio Kane stood up and reached into his jacket, withdrawing his sunglasses.
It appears that Miss Sparkle, he one-lined, sliding his shades over his eyes, has calculated all the variables. An enormous mare with a platinum coat, silver mane and tail, and deep turquoise eyes in the back row stood on her hind leg, opened her mouth, and screamed at the top of her lungs,
"Yeah!" The mare quickly sat back down at all the stares which came her way in response to a random outburst, blushing and silently cursing whatever intangible force it compelled her to do that. Discord stood in Hell's mismatched hands up, shouting,
"It's a draw!"
And with that, the nonsense was finished. Praise the sun. And that's how this story was made. The end. The real end.
Or is it?
No, it is. Right? Sequel coming next week. In maybe. Okay, so that was, I'm terribly sorry for the moments that were not funny. It's been, I think, 2 hours? I'm coming up on 2 hours at this point. I'm at desktop Y. I'm at I'm at an hour and 48 minutes into this. So, that was lovely. So, obviously you have to, I am totally following you now, because I really have to be a part of this next time. And thank you to Rainbow Crash 88. That is not Rainbow Crash 88! The blasphemy! Lies! See this is the original creator. Where's the pinky thing from the... No! Well, okay. Alright. In all fairness, this is one of the people who helped work on the project. Rainbow Crash gets credit for it, but Whitetail did help with a lot of the themes. And RC told me that when I messaged him one time about, you know, I left a fan comment, you know, saying how awesome the music was, and he said, yeah, I'm not the only guy who worked on these. Actually, Whitetail Music helped me out a lot, so give credit where due. I'm sorry for that little outburst. Lovely music, by the way. This one is actually my favorite, and I'm so sad that the project went down, because I really want to... I would love to have played as Pinkie Pie in, like, a cupcake palace with this music playing. It would have been absolutely perfect. Like... So, anyways, I hope you enjoyed this. If the file worked properly... This is up on YouTube, and you're probably watching from this page. My comment should still be down here somewhere. Somewhere. Control F, you're my best friend. Leading raindrops. A Okay, it's probably on the first, this one. Where's my comment? I made a comment on this. I know I did. This is not okay. No, I'm not alright with this. This is not okay. Fine. Well, in any case, you're probably watching from this page because this is where I plan to post it. So, that concludes this strange video.